Rejsende i Sydafrika benytter ofte bed and breakfast. Her får man til en rimelig pris en personlig og hyggelig betjening af husets ejere. For det meste er disse steder af meget høj kvalitet. I byen Sabi i Mpumalanga, der ligger som naby til Kruger Nationalpark, møder vi Chris Colvert, der sammen med sin kone Morag netop har overtaget stedet Wayfarers.
Right now we've just started our own guest house. It was an existing business which we were lucky enough to find in August, and we purchased it and we arrived here in Sabi in the end of October 2005, and we had our first guests about 3 days later, unofficial ones. We weren't even open. Two Germans walked up the driveway, very tired. They'd flown from Germany, driven from Johannesburg, and they were desperate for a room. They said the packing cases wouldn't worry them, and then we officially opened on the 7th of November, and we've had quite a steady stream of guests from all over the world ever since. And it's looking like a successful venture. It's a nice part of the world. With a very pleasant guest house, and we think it'll be something that'll make us happy for some time. We initially looked at a guest house in Namibia, between Windhoek and Etosha, in a place called Otjiwarongo. Otjiwarongo is basically a transit camp for people going from A to B, and mainly from Windhoek to Etosha in the north. We decided it wasn't a nice town to live in. It was a bit dusty and dry and not much else to do. We looked on the internet and my wife did a search. We chose this area because we like Kruger National Park very much. We've been there many times. We love wildlife and I love photography. We know it's a beautiful part of the world. It's very like Canada, I think, and particularly Scotland, with the forests and the hills and the mountains and the lakes. We found a lot of properties on the market. Sabi, Nelspruit, White River, Komati Port, Malalaan. So we made an appointment with an estate agent. We drove from Windhoek, 1,800 kilometers through Botswana, through South Africa. We arrived, and then the following morning we looked at 7 properties before lunch, first day. One of them was Wayfarers Guest House. We went and had lunch. We sat and talked about what we'd seen. I said, I think I've got very good vibes about Wayfarers. Let's go and have a second look. We decided to make an offer. I mean, I've lived in South Africa during apartheid, and it wasn't that wonderful. One felt restricted, one felt embarrassed, one knew what was happening. It was difficult to do much about it as a non-South African citizen, one couldn't vote. But if you liked the country, one had to put up with it and hoped it would go away. And it was very nice in the early 90s when Nelson Mandela was freed and the ANC was made legal. A lot of people left the country, a lot of people went to Australia, they ran away, they were scared, they thought it would be a bloodshed. I personally always said, why should it be? The country's big, it's got a massive infrastructure, a lot of people live here, there's too much to lose. All we need is a good middle class, African developed, so they've got a good income, they've got something to live for, and it's happened quite quickly. In 13 years we're now definitely seeing a very upper-class African emerging with a good job, good earnings, nice cars, good manners, educated. And I think we've come through what could have been a big trauma quite well, really do. And I'm seeing it more and more every day now. People are confident, they're beginning to travel. And I think the country should go from strength to strength, really.
We also got the cars nice in these hills.
Sydafrika har en kedelig rekord i antallet af HIV- og AIDS-ramte. Townshipen Guguletu er en del af slumområdet Cape Flats, der ligger på bagsiden af Tafelbjerget lige uden for Cape Town. Arbejdsløshed og fattigdom præger området. Det er ikke et turistmål for hvide. Her kommer man kun, hvis man har et vigtigt ærne. Og det har Dr. Catherine Orell. Hun arbejder på hospitalet med et projekt, der skal uddanne en gruppe behandlingsvejledere.
Well, we're here because this is a new project. It's a joint venture between a funding organization in England that's supplying us with antiretroviral therapy for 150 patients, the province that's supplying us with the space, and the other doctor that you met next door is employed by the province, and ourselves, which is the sort of research unit, the academic input. And what we're doing is trying to set up an antiretroviral treatment program in a primary healthcare setting in Africa. So we want to show, and in fact, we're also positive that we're going to show that we can actually manage antiretroviral therapy adequately with far beyond ordinary standard virological suppression and adherence to therapy from a primary healthcare setting. The big sort of feather in our cap are the treatment counsellors who are themselves all HIV positive and who are all on therapy and who have been trained as counsellors and support personnel to support our 150 patients on treatment. At the moment we have 6 counsellors employed, by the end we'll have about 10 and they will each have 15 patients for whom they are personally responsible. We're also seeing a number of patients who were screened 2 weeks ago who are coming now for their bloods, for their CD4 counts, their viral loads, and they will sign today an agreement, which is an agreement between us and them, between the council and them, or myself and them, whoever signs a piece of paper, just to basically say we will supply them with antiretroviral therapy, we will supply them with information about therapy, and we will supply them with support in terms of adherence. We will provide clinical care. I will examine you. We will take blood to make sure that things are safe. So that we will give you treatment and we will also make sure that it's safe. Okay. We will talk to you about the medications and educate you. And I'm sure you have missed a bit of that without Nomoroma, but you need to learn a little bit about the medications. Okay. And we will support you in staying on treatment. And all those things are what we agree to give to you. But in return, we're going to be taking things from you back, okay? So we want you to take your medications as we prescribe. It's very, very important that you take these medicines every day, okay? Because these medicines don't take the virus out of your body. They're not a cure, as you know. They just push the virus down, and it's like putting a lid on the pot. We have a short meeting every morning. We have a longer meeting on it. We're presently running part-time, 3 afternoons a week, and that's because this clinic gets quiet in the afternoon so we can have these rooms. In the morning it's busy. So we all sort of congregate at about 1:30. Our patients are booked for 2:00. And we just discuss issues, problems, things that have arisen, ask them if they've had any problems with their home visits and visiting their patients. Has anyone contacted them? We've got some patients on drug. Have they had any problems? And before we move on to the day's new and repeated patients. We call them adherence monitors, and they've been trained to help people stay on therapy, because with antiretroviral therapy, ideally, you need to achieve an adherence of 95% to medication. So that's missing less than one dose a month, one dose in every 6 weeks or so. We need more medication. We need more money for staff and that kind of thing. We need to be opening clinics in all the districts, not just this one. But I mean, I think if we can show that it can be done, we're doing a very important thing, not just for these 150 patients, but also more broadly. It's a challenge. It's a big challenge. Turning people away is heartrending. It's horrible. But we see patients who are too ill to start therapy, who are basically brought in a wheelchair, who are pre-terminal, and who this therapy is not going to do anything for. And they come to you and you are their very last hope, and you say sorry, and that's horrible. And because of the state of the epidemic at the moment, we've had quite a few of those pre-terminal people. In fact, 2 of our patients have died in the last few weeks. People that we thought were okay and we screened, you know, not even the people we've said no to, people that we actually screened have died because we're starting off and we're trying to sort of, we really are dropping a drop into an ocean of illness. And the doctors that refer us patients send us their desperately ill patients that they're stuck with, and we have to turn them away. And that's quite harsh. So it is a challenge, but we'll get there. We'll get there. Yeah.
Yeah.